Let's get started. What's yours? Good evening, everybody. Welcome to the MAS monthly meeting, a virtual style. This is the meeting for October 2021. Welcome, everyone.
How soon till we're in person?
Let the board talk about that. Okay. I have the same problem every month. I cannot forward a slide. Okay. So this is the list of all the board members. I know Vault is on. I know Trina's on. I know Matt's on. I have not seen Gunnar or Conrad tonight. So what's nice, though, is here's a picture of everybody and names to go with pictures. Anybody has any issues with any MAS activity, MAS operation, any observatory, any questions, feel free to contact anybody that's on the board. That's why we're here. We're here to answer your questions and to serve you to make your experience better. So, please contact us. Welcome new members. I made a list of Steve's list that he sent out. I captured the new members off of that list, and I thought, you know what, why shouldn't I start pointing these people out and letting everybody know, hey, look who's joined in the last month. So here's my effort on that. Welcome new members. And like I say, you're new to us, we're new to you. Let's see if we can do anything for you. Let somebody on the board know, somebody know, a leader at one of the sites, whatever. If there's something that you need, something that you have an idea, certainly float it by us. So thank you, volunteers. I do this every month. Particularly, I know there's been a group. I know Steve and Vic, I saw on the forums that you guys went down there and did a work party down there and got that west fence all stained up and made pretty. That really looks nice. That looks good. And then I know there was a huge turnout for the September BSIG. I heard there was a lot of people there. Bolts, I think, told me that there was a ton of people, probably one of the bigger ones that has happened in a while.
And it's like 90 something.
Yeah, that's incredible. I still don't know where he put everybody. There must have been people hanging in the trees for as all I know, because that place is big, but I don't know, 90 people, that had to have been fun.
Yeah, we had to turn cars away and have them park in the street. We had so many. We had 45 cars in the space, and I don't know how many telescopes, but it was a gigantic group, and it really was a lot of fun and a perfect viewing night too.
Yeah, that's what I thought. It was a beautiful night.
Yeah.
I know there's continued work going on the website. I got a little bit more about that in a little bit. And I know there's star parties have been happening at ELO too. So thank you. Thank you. Thank you. All you volunteers, you are what makes this machine roll. So keep it up, and I know there's probably some opportunities this weekend to volunteer in ELO. That's coming up too. Speaking of help wanted. Waltz, here you go.
All right. So as Mark mentioned, we are moving forward with our new website. It is slowly coming together. The website design firm gave us a great template, and we are slowly populating all of the content. We are still looking for volunteers to help us out. We still have a lot of stuff to port over. So if there's anybody that's got some experience with WordPress, especially with the Divi Builder Editor, please reach out to Mark or myself, and we will welcome you to the web development team. It's a lot of fun, but it takes a little bit of time, but I think the product that we're putting together is really good. And it's going to be it works really well on mobile, and it's going to be very, very useful.
And I heard there's an awesome calendar.
Calendar is awesome. The web interface is awesome. I just finished the weather pages, and the weather pages are working really well.
Cool. Yeah, so contact bolts, it'd be very, very cool if we could get that rolling before the spring activities start.
Yeah, what we'd like to do is to roll that out by the start of next year, so we don't have to load up two calendars for the old website and the new website, so we can just flip the switch and go over the new website and then automate that calendar going forward. It's going to save us a lot of time and a lot of effort going forward.
Awesome. Thank you, Vault. Just a reminder, the listserv, if anybody used to uses a listserv anymore, your emails that you're creating on there are not going anywhere. You should refer to the website. I know the website has these emails and contacts and distribution lists. That certainly is a place that you should start. But if you're still using listserv stuff, that those no longer work. So, be warned. And also just a reminder, I haven't checked lately. I meant to check today, but I forgot. Must have been distracted by something else. But Slack is a tool. I think the biggest group on there is the astrophotography group. And then after that, I think it's like observing or maybe even like CGO or something like that. There's quite a few people. So, it's a great place to communicate quickly. You can bounce things back and forth really fast. If there's other participants on there, just to let everyone know. And you do have to be a member. If there's non-members on this call, you do have to be a member to get a Slack account. That's kind of a kickback of the being a member of the MAS.
Are there instructions on how to do that?
Yeah, there are. There's instructions on the forum. Can you go back one?
Yeah, send an email to that web address on that last slide, and Chris Setness will set you up.
Okay.
Also, the MAS is on YouTube, so this video of this meeting, of this Zoom call, will be put up there. It will be put up there probably early next week, because I'll download it as soon as Zoom tells me that it's ready. I'll download it tonight and I'll convert it, because it's got to be converted to delete out the front and the back end and a little editing in the middle. And then it's posted up there. So you can connect that. I don't know, Vaults, we should put a connection on our website for that, maybe somewhere on the homepage, maybe. But if you do a search, Minnesota Astronomical Society on YouTube, you find it.
It'll be front and center on the new website.
Awesome. Anton, if you're on, would you want to talk about the Loner Scope program for just a bit?
Sure, I'm here. And as always, members can request one of our 14 telescopes to take for a month and do some observing. So far this year, 67 loans have gone out. I've got a couple more scheduled for this week. Members interested in borrowing a telescope, go to the website under members, and then Loner Scope program under that, and you can make your request. No one's been denied a telescope. We've had plenty. Occasionally, you might have to wait if there's one particular telescope that you want, but everyone's gotten a telescope this year. We also have our library of DVDs, short courses from great courses on all things astronomical. And that entire list is posted on that same page on the website, and it's also published in the Gemini. So take advantage of those. There are some really good courses in there. Just if you're interested, the single most borrowed telescope this year so far has been the Corona Solar Scope. It has gone out 8 times, so it's the leader this year so far. Anybody's got any questions?
Is there any big questions from anybody? If not, I agree, that's a great program. That's how I got into the club. That's how I began to acquire my collection of telescopes because of this loaner scope program, good or bad. So, some events going on before the next meeting. New moon. I guess new moon was last night. And then there's a draconid. I didn't do a lot of research on it, but I didn't find a lot about it. I just know that it's there. And we should get a great view of them from here because it's so high in our sky throughout the night. So they should be there. I don't know what the rate is. I presume it's quite low because the mass media hasn't attached themselves to it yet and talked about it. And then there's some planetary things associated with the moon coming up in the next week or so. Venus and then Antares. And then at the end of the month, another meteor shower, which unfortunately coincides so close to the full moon. I really don't see how we're going to see too many of them. I suppose you'd see the bright ones. But probably be a few more than normal. And then Venus' greatest eastern elongation and new moon on November 4th, the same night as our next virtual MAS monthly meeting.
Hey, Mark, if I could interject here, we are at the last beginner special interest group, star party last month, and I know we got another one coming up a week from this weekend. I just wanted to mention, talk about planets. Out at that location, we were able to see Saturn, then Jupiter, then Neptune, then Uranus. And if you haven't seen all the four gas giants all in the same night, that's kind of a cool thing to be able to do. So I just want to mention that.
Yep, that's, and what's nice about that is as they come parading through, they keep getting higher and higher as the night goes along. So that's, I know for that site out there at Metcalf, that can only help. So thanks, Matt. Next slide. Oops, I guess I didn't finish editing that, but I have October star party. So this weekend is Astronomy Day out at ELO. That's a public event. And then the other public star party, ELO, is on October 23rd. I have a slide later. So Merle, if you're on, get ready. And then, like Matt said, a week from this weekend is another beginner special interest group star party at Metcalf Field. Saturday night is the primary night, and Shresh has posted that 6 p.m. is the start time because it gets dark. I mean, it'll be dark next week by 6:30, I think, or even sooner. I guess that's farther east. I'm thinking about my time. And then Friday there is the backup.
And to be slightly fair here, we do set up before sunrise or sunset, I'm sorry, because it does give us an opportunity to kind of see the equipment in daylight. And also Suresh does give a instructional talk on types of telescopes and things like that.
So cool. And then there's three member opportunities in this month. LLCC star party next weekend or this weekend. And I presume that there'll be people up there if it's clear. I haven't looked up there. And then there's a CGO star party with the 4M, and we'll talk about the 4M here in a little bit. The MAS Mini Messy Marathon. We'll talk about that in a little bit. And then there's to end the month, there's a star party at CGO Friday, Saturday. So Astronomy Day at ELO. Merle, if you're on, I know one thing that's needed, and that's more volunteers, because when I looked at the forums, it looked like there's only like 3 or 4 volunteers signed up. So if anybody has time available and you don't necessarily have to be a key holder member to show up there and help, I believe, for that weekend or for that event. So Merle, if you're on, is there anything else we need to add?
No, I think you got it covered. We do need a few more key holders to run the equipment, etc. But I think we're we got all the speakers lined up, all the door prizes ready to go. So yeah. We're good.
And just to let everybody know, we do have COVID restrictions out there inside buildings. Masks are still required, whether you're vaccinated or not. I'll just throw that out, and you could take it from there.
And Mark, what's the best way for volunteers to sign up to volunteer for said sites and events?
Well, you can use the forum. That's one way. And I presume if you showed up out there and found Merle or another key holder out there, you certainly, they're not going to send you home because you're there to volunteer. So, I know it would be nice if everybody signed up, but if there's a chance that you don't or just show up, that's fine too. I'm sure all help would be welcomed, but the forum under the ELO discussion forums, which you can get to through our website, through the members pull down, you can get to the members forum, and there you'd look for the ELO discussion forum, and you can add your list to the topic there is Astronomy Day. So
now our Astronomy Day, our Fall Astronomy Day starts 2 o'clock. Activities start at 2 o'clock. Observatory opens at 2 o'clock. We are having a pre-Fall Astronomy Day work party that starts at 11 a.m. And we have paintbrushes. So anybody coming out, expect to paint for a little bit.
So you're going to paint before everybody shows up tomorrow?
Yes.
Huh. Are you still having training? Speaking of that, are you still having training? Are you having keyholder refresher training?
Yes, keyholder refresher training. Primarily to go over the motor operation of the Onan Observatory.
What time does that start?
1 o'clock.
Okay. So it's an action, fun-filled, packed weekend at ELO, or at least Saturday anyway.
Yep. So all these people that aren't going to Northern or aren't going to LLCC because it's cloudy, you can come on out to ELO.
Where it's cloudy.
Help out. Wow, it's cloudy for work, doesn't matter.
All right. Thank you, Merle.
Hey, Mark, I got a comment.
Go ahead, Dave.
I think we need a new picture for Onan.
For ELO. I need a picture for Merle then if we need a new picture.
Back up. Let's see that.
I can't back up.
So, Merle, the picture has the old wooden staircase and none of the railing.
Yeah. Well, there are new pictures on the website. There are new pictures. Yep.
So the ELO press just needs to get hooked up.
Yeah, hook me up, Merle. Mini Messier Marathon, a.k.a. the 4M. The MAS Mini Messy Marathon. So, Chris Sentness, if you're on, I'll let you talk about this.
Yeah, I'm on, and the 4M is a little bit more relaxed than the Messier Marathon in the spring, and we decided this year to open it up to try to get as many bases covered as possible. So we're going to allow an astrophotography part of that in addition to the traditional no computerized visual and the computerized visual categories. So there'll be three categories to the Messier Marathon. Weather-wise, it's looking right now like this is going to be tomorrow night. I'm holding off on the call because that forecast for tomorrow night has been a little bit hit and miss. It has been consistently rain on Saturday night, though. So if we have it, it'll probably be tomorrow night. That's what I got.
Where are you going to publish your call?
It'll be on the forums. I'll post it to Slack as well for those watching that. But I will post to the forums probably tomorrow morning.
All right, very good. Thank you, Chris. And we do have prizes, just to let everybody know.
There's top prizes. Three. And the other thing that's on this slide that's important is if, you know, we're having the event at Cherry Grove, you can participate from other places if you'd like. All I need is an email with, you know, how many objects you got, that sort of thing. So.
Awesome. Very cool. I hope it works out.
I do too.
All right, next slide, beginners. Suresh, if you're on, you want to add anything, please jump in. But basically, I covered this October 16th, 6 p.m. start time. Friday night is the backup. Metcalf Field does not have power yet, but it's close, though.
Yeah, all I would add to this is if you have a telescope, if you're trying to bring equipment, please come, you know, try to get there by 6. And all attendees are requested to arrive in daylight because it's just hard to find the place at night. So just please try to arrive in daylight.
Very good. Suresh, you've been doing awesome jobs this summer and fall, organizing these and running these. They've been a huge success. And, you know, I think that's another place where we are seeing an increase in our membership as a result of these things. So thank you, Suresh, for taking care of this. Just a little recap on Northern Nights. I got this from Greg Hombrecht today. Looks like there's 5 people that are going to get a certificate. Looks like Derek Overdahl and John Zimich and Mark Zimich and Dave Faulkner. And then Greg Hombrecht has his here where he's listed as the participant and then he also signed it. I'm kind of going, well, hey, that's me. That kind of looks a little fishy. But, you know, Greg's off at Oki Tech, so he's not here to defend himself. So I figured I'd give him a little.
Thank goodness it's not a financial document.
I know that would be, you know, we'd have to go, well, what are the other endorsements on there? So I'm not going to question it. I trust Greg. Anybody that knows Greg, we trust Greg. So it looks like it. I mean, from my aspect, my point of view, it was my first one, the first time I'd ever been to LLCC, and it was a blast. Definitely something on my list of things for 2022 for sure. Just a little plug here.
Go
about
back to
COVID.
That picture of the field, if you would.
You're asking for a miracle. Yeah. Vic, was that you that said go back to the field?
Oh, that was me, and I've seen what I was looking for. It's that's a Wednesday or a Thursday night setup where there are no scopes or just a lot of places to. A few scopes, but a lot of tarps underground, staking out a place that maybe they could use.
This was, let's see, Wednesday night. This was Thursday morning. I walked out on the field Thursday morning, getting ready for the meeting Thursday night, and I snapped this with my cell phone. So, yes, you're correct, Jim.
This one right to go ahead.
So just a little ad about COVID, you know, if you're inside a building of MAS proper, we still are requiring masks to be worn inside observatories or buildings. There's no restrictions for our ISPs, but please continue to post your plans to use facilities during this time. Just post in the proper observatory forum that you are planning to attend an ISP. Thank you. Thank you for that. Thank you for understanding. And then just a little thing about that, you know, some have been curious about when we're going to meet face-to-face. The board's still working on that. We've kind of pushed it to next year. That's kind of where we're at right now, and we'll continue to work on that, you know, if... had there not been this Delta variant, I'm pretty sure we'd be there. There's just too many families, too many kids, and they're unvaccinated. And the schools, at least from what I read, you know, this is the headlines that I read in the papers, that the state of Minnesota seems to have a problem with the schools, and looks like they're still having some issues that they're working through. So. until it's totally cleared up, I think we want to just push it off for a little bit. Next thing is Father Brown, I know, is always looking for articles for the Gemini. And, you know, he'll take anything and everything. I haven't, astronomy related, that is. And I haven't read the recent issue, but I presume it was jam-packed again with all kinds of articles. And, you know, it's this membership, it's our membership that keeps that thing going without any outside material to fill the pages. It's all member driven. So I think that's kind of a great thing. And so if you have anything, you know, the list there, travel experiences, which I saw just the headline that there's a travel experience in this last one. You know, where have you gone? What have you seen? What kind of new equipment have you tried? Any issues you've had? New software? Always interested in new software. Please write an article. Submit it to Father Brown. Better know a constellation. I saw that in the headline that Trina sent out through MailChimp. Sorry, I did not take the time to prepare one. And I know why. Jerry took off and he went to the Okitex area, Black Mesa, something out there. So he bailed on us and he said that it's most likely going to be clear and I don't have time. So you know how that goes. So if anybody is interested, even, it doesn't always have to be Jerry and it doesn't have to be me. If you're interested, please let me know. We certainly would like to keep this going. If nobody contacts me and Jerry isn't going to do it, well, then you guys are going to be stuck with me next month because I will prepare something and who knows what I'm going to drag up.
Hey, Mark, I think it's useful to say that when you're going to do one of these get to know a constellations or whatever you call it, you don't have to know anything about it when you start, because that's what you do is you learn about it and then you share that with the club. So
yeah, it sounds like you just volunteered.
Yeah, thanks a lot. Okay. But it's really a neat thing because...
All those in favor say aye.
No, aye.
This isn't a board meeting, guys. I'll see what I can do. Thank you.
Let me know, Matt.
Yeah,
I will. Yes, I agree with Matt. I've done enough of them that if you you start out and you don't know anything about the constellation, by the time you're done, you're going to know something about it. And you know, you don't have to be a great presenter. You just have to be an average presenter. And you know, it's there's no stars, there's no Yelp, there's nothing. We just, you'll get a thank you at the end. I guarantee you that.
Just share what you learned. That's what we're all about here.
Okay. Astronomy League Awards. Well, Jerry Jones, absent, out stargazing. So he told me he didn't have any. So that's also another thing, but. His last message, though, is get out there and observe. So next slide. So our next meeting, November 4th, is our very own Dave Faulkner. And I know, Dave, I got you on the hook because I got this slide from you. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to let you speak to it.
All right. So as some of you may know, I recently published another book called The Stories of Astronomers and Their Stars. And I'm not going to really have a presentation about the book itself as much as it's going to be a presentation about the backstory. How I came to write this book, some of the trials and tribulations I had writing the book, and just kind of that whole business. If you want the book, it's certainly available on Amazon. And I'll have copies out at Astronomy Day too, if you want to come out there. But I think you'll find it interesting. Writing a book is probably a lot different than many of you may think. So that's what it's going to be about.
All right. Thank you, Dave. Next slide. So I think our next slide, why stuck again? Our next slide is our feature presentation with Mr. Ron Schmit, our very own Ron Schmit. And I'm going to stop presenting and turn it over to you, Ron.
All right. Thanks, Space Gandalf. And we'll do this, and we'll do this, and we'll do this. Lovely. Am I echoing on someone's ear?
Nope, you're doing great. Somebody's mic is open, though.
Yep, that's what I noticed. All right, good evening, everybody. Thanks for letting me come visit. My name is Ron Schmit. Been a longtime member of the MAS, and I'm also a solar system ambassador for JPL. The solar system ambassador program is about 730 people throughout the U.S. selected to attend trainings and get information on the JPL missions. And then we go out and we tell you fine people about that, including the 16 members we have in Minnesota and our own Dave Faulkner and Brad Nassett, also solar system ambassadors.
Hey, Ron, is that a presidential appointment?
Papal, actually.
Papal?
Wow. No. They have... sorry, I'm fighting a cold, but Ebola Kinshasa came back negative. No, they have a application process every year. You can sign up for that, and then they review your application and set you up. So you've heard of NASA. National Aeronautic and Space Administration, JPL, is the part of NASA that's in charge of the robotic exploration of the solar system. So they're sending the bots and not the boots. So I wanted to come in today and tell you about the geology of Jezero Crater, the landing site for the Perseverance rover. We'll talk a little bit about that and give you an update on what Perseverance has found so far, how things are going. We will pause from time to time. Matt, if I could get some help watching the chat, because I don't have the massive screen to show me the chat window at the same time. So if you could pull me over to a stop if we've got any questions that show up in the chat room, and be happy to take care of those for you if we can.
We got you covered.
Super. You guys are the bestest. That doesn't work. There we go. All right. Oh, there's our beautiful blue marble. Mother Earth. You know, some people ask why we spend money in space. Well, we don't spend any money in space. It's all spent down on the Earth, paying for engineers and scientists and technicians and people that build these things and fly them. Generates our economy and keeps us solvent, at least until October. What is it, the 15th? But part of NASA's mission is off of the Earth for the Earth. See, if we look at the Earth, we can see red, or I'm sorry, we can see blue, we can see white, we can see green and brown. That represents the surface of our Earth. That surface has been impacted from space about 187 confirmed times. Yes, I'm sure there have been hits here in Central Africa or out in the Gobi, out in the desert, maybe up in Greenland, but these are confirmed sites. So if you're digging in Europe and you find a crater hole, then yes, you've found one. So there are places where undeveloped sites that have probably been hit as well. But 187 confirmed impact structures on the Earth. One of the more popular is Meteor Crater. One's called Barringer Crater, purchased by old man Barringer using his family fortune. He thought he'd find a magical space rock down at the bottom of that hole, about a mile across. He found nothing. The impactor exploded completely when it hit and made that dent in the surface of the Earth. So if you want to go out on Winslow, Arizona, such a fine sight to see, you can pull up to the gift shop there and look over the edge of the crater and marvel at its wonder. So the Earth has been hit before. Now, there was some debate as to whether some of these structures were actually volcanic in nature, maybe an old ancient caldera. But Eugene Shoemaker, a geologist of note here in the U.S., helped the astronauts prepare for their moon missions and walking around, finding rocks on the moon. He studied Barringer Crater, and he found that at the base of Barringer Crater, you could find a certain species of quartz that was shocked by incredible pressures and high temperatures, pressures that you wouldn't achieve in a volcano. So if you find cosite, this quartz material at the bottom of a crater, then you know it's an impact site and not a volcano, or a volcanic caldera. So there's examples throughout the world. We find like this one in Western Africa, a little tougher to see. Sometimes they're easy to see. Here's the Manicouagan up in Quebec, Canada. I always get misty when I see pictures from the shuttle. There's her tail right there. There's another impact site just a little bit northwest of that as well. Not so obvious when you're on the ground, of course, but from space, pretty easy to see, like the Vredefort crater in South Africa. The Sudbury crater in Ontario, a little harder to see, but the ellipse is there. Yeah, there we go. Papagai crater in Siberia, Russia. We'll meet that one again later. The Ackerman crater in southern Australia. Kara crater in Russia. Beaverhead crater in Idaho. This one's really tough to see, so we're just getting a nice view of the Idaho countryside. And finally, the Chicxulub crater in the Yucatan. If there are any paleontologists on the call, I apologize. I don't want to step on your toes, but we have found that apparently this crater is what caused the extinction of the dinosaurs. An impact 65 million years ago blew up a dust storm to cover the Earth, blocking out the sun and taking away important flora and fauna, choking off the dinosaurs' life force and putting an end to them. There we go. But you know, with all that water, with all that atmosphere, the Earth has been recycled many, many times. Since the Earth has life, we've got this top layer. This is the only place you're going to find it in the whole solar system. This is soil. This is the organic material left over from living things. Rotted plants, dead animals, as they die and decay, the material goes back into the soil, provides nutrients for other life. Because Earth is the only place that we've found life, this is the only place where we find soil. This is also the only place where we find alluvium because there's water down inside the ground, water tables, rivers under the surface. And then we finally get to the bedrock. The bedrock of the Earth is mostly basalt, a common ordinary volcanic rock called basalt. But this is the only place you'll find that cross section in the whole solar system because we have life. And with our atmosphere, with our wind and water, rain, temperature changes, we have erosion. We have our rock cycle. Rocks come up out of the magma. They form igneous rocks. Heat and pressure changes them to metamorphic. They lift to the surface, get eroded, settle down, get concreted into sedimentary rocks. Maybe they go back into the magma. Maybe they change. So rocks have their own cycle as well. Now, granted, the timeline is much longer. We're not so privy to that all the time. But that is a force that's going on the Earth, and that changes our surface around. If we want to see the oldest rocks on the Earth, we have to go to the eastern coast of the Hudson Bay in the Greenstone Belt, where we have rocks about 4.3 billion years old, or rocks in the Jack Hills of Western Australia, dated at 4.4 billion years old. But pretty much all the other rocks on the Earth have been recycled, stuffed back down into the magma to reconstitute, either through subduction, volcanism, plate tectonics, sedimentation, erosion, all those forces at work change the surface of the Earth. So how are we going to know what the ancient Earth was like? Well, we can look around. We can look around at the other planets in our solar system because they formed at about the same time. Now, these are also hard, rocky, crusty planets. We call them the inner planets. You can walk around on them. They have a surface. And you're like, well, duh, Mr. Schmit, it's a planet. Yeah, but the other four, you can't. These are the gas giants. There's no surface to walk around on. You try to land on Jupiter, you end up in the clouds getting crushed and melted into goo before you ever touch bottom. There might not even be a bottom there. I think Dave could talk about that with Juno. Yeah.
I was asleep and I missed a question. That there's someone posted, Peter Miller, there's now some evidence that other factors such as massive volcanism may have been the important, may have been as important as Chicxulub.
Yes.
Chicxulub.
Yes. We'll give you that. 65 million years ago, there's a lot to be uncovered.
Okay. And then your mic is acting weird.
Well, for Suresh, it is, but okay. Dave says it's fine.
That's what I thought too. All right, let's roll.
All right, so we've got our inner planets, our hard, rocky, crusty planets. We get to the edge where the leftovers are. You can see my cursor. Okay, so here's the pirate ship. Here's the leftover Legos, right? Or here's the cake. Here's the leftover flour, the leftover ingredients when the inner solar system formed. Beyond that, we have the realm of the gas giants. And there they are in comparison to the inner planets. Take all those inner planets. They fit right inside this little square with Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, Neptune. Yes, Pluto's still here. Don't bother me with it. I know. Blah, blah, blah. But let's head back to our neighborhood, the moon. This is a hard, rocky, crusty body. Now, it's not a planet. It is a moon. It's a satellite. It's in orbit around the Earth. But notice the color. That grayish color of the moon is because the moon is also made of basalt, just like the Earth. In fact, if we want to go to Mercury, the planet closest to the sun, that is also made of basalt. That's why it looks like the moon. It has the same coloration because it's got similar rock composition. And like the moon, there's no atmosphere. There's nothing to wipe out the craters. So these craters have been there for a very, very long time. We stop out next to Venus and you're like, oh yeah, Mr. Schmidt, well, Venus looks different. Hey, I'll give you that. But Venus is covered with a thick, thick, thick cloud layer. So when we look at Venus telescopically, even from orbit, we can't see the surface. But the Magellan probe could, launched by the space shuttle Magellan, orbited Venus for about 11 years and mapped out the surface of Venus. We've even had four spacecraft from Russia, the former Soviet Union, the Venera spacecraft, land on the surface and take a picture of the rocks. And that's what the rocks look like. Does that look familiar? Sure, it does. It's the same sort of basalt we see on Mercury and the moon and the Earth. So these are all made of the same stuff. Oops, now we get to Mars. What do you got for me now, smart guy? Well, Mars is orange. I'll give you that. But Mars was also once wet. That's why it looks different. You dig underneath that crunchy orange surface, and you've got basalt underneath there. Just like you've got on Mercury and the moon and Venus and Earth. So what happened to Mars? That's what we're trying to find out. In fact, present day Mars on the right, ancient day Mars, maybe on the left, adding a thicker atmosphere and water, Mars could have looked a lot like the Earth. But then it didn't. Now, before we leave our solar system entirely, let's get back to those asteroids for a second, because those asteroids can provide a very valuable resource as well. And that's a look at the early solar system. Now, asteroids are asteroids because they're not round. One of the requirements for a planet or even a dwarf planet is that it's got to be large enough to be hydrostatically round. In other words, when it formed in a molten state, the hydrostatic pressure was enough to make it a sphere. And as it cooled, it stayed a sphere. And as you can see, these aren't spheres. They're crazy potato shapes. They look like nerd candies. There's a variety of different, but remember, these formed back when the solar system was young. The largest population is near the asteroid belt. And although it looks like you couldn't drive through it with the Millennium Falcon, you know, C-3PO telling you how dangerous it is, there's plenty of room. There are a lot of asteroids, but they're very spread out. So normally when I see these asteroids, they're very pockmarked with lots of craters because there's no erosion process there. And about the only time that surface changes is when something else runs into it, like Vesta or Ceres. Now, Ceres is actually big enough to be hydrostatically round. And so that got promoted to the dwarf planet list along with Pluto and Eris and some of our other buddies. What happened there? Oh, there we go. There's our dwarf planets. I'm sorry, that slide, UB2003, UB313, that was eventually called Eris. So that's an old graphic there. And I really don't care where you fall on the dwarf planet list. It's a terrible definition, and they'll probably have to change it anyway. So, why isn't the moon named something like other than moon? Well, back then, for thousands and thousands, probably tens of thousands of years, the moon was the only moon we knew about. And so we called it the moon. And it wasn't until 1609 when we had the telescope and we could see moons around other bodies that it was, hey, there are other moons there. So our moon is the proper name moon. And then we applied that to the other ones. You could call them natural satellites, I suppose, but you know, why ruin the fun? One of those asteroids is Bennu. Bennu is a little bit more of a rock pile than a rock itself. It's a rubble pile held together loosely by gravity. And again, the surface, very, very old from the dawn of the solar system. Bennu was visited by OSIRIS-REx, which last year headed home, taking its sample from the surface, tucking it in, and sending it back to Earth. It is on its way. A Japanese probe called Hayabusa did the same thing back in 2019. It sampled the surface with this sample horn down here, scooped it up, put it on board a little reentry vehicle, and then it dropped it off, coming back through the atmosphere, protected by its heat shield, its parachute taking it all the way down to the surface of the outback in Australia. Here you can see it as it reenters the atmosphere, slowing down using its heat shield, eventually a parachute bringing it down, and there's a technician carrying the sample package away. So we hope to do the same thing with Bennu in 2 years when it returns back to the Earth, depositing its sample in the deserts of Utah. So here we go back to Mars.
Hey, Ron.
Oh, yeah.
There's a question from, if my chat would work, from Steve. Do we have a good idea of what percentage of the asteroids are metallic versus the rocky slash rubble pile ones?
No, as we get closer inspection of them, the rocky stuff is by far the highest concentration. But there are other metals spread throughout. There are some that seem more metallic. Psyche comes to mind as one that seems very, very dense, that they haven't sampled the surface, but they can derive from its apparent density that it's going to be, you know, heavily metallic. That's one of them that they talked about, an asteroid retrieval mission to bring that back and start mining that. So doing some space mining.
Interesting.
Yeah, pretty cool stuff. So Mars has been heavily explored by our planet. Russia, China now, India, UK, they have all sent probes to Mars. Here we have orbiters still in orbit around Mars, and then our landers, including the Mars exploration rovers, Spirit and Opportunity, now dead on the surface, along with Phoenix. Curiosity still running around. InSight still there. ExoMars Rover 2020, that's from ESA. Actually, COVID held that up. They haven't been able to launch yet, but we do have the Rover 2020, which eventually got the name Perseverance. So they had a contest. They opened it up to school kids. Yes, we couldn't apply. I wanted endurance. And there's Oliver Jacobs of Virginia taking mine. So they had three groups, elementary school kids, middle school kids, and high school kids. And the winner, Perseverance. From Alexander Mather of Virginia. He did a nice little essay on why they should call it Perseverance, too. So they changed the name. On its way to Mars, it got renamed. All right, I'm going to stop here, stop my share, hop over to the video, and I want to show you a little review of the mission. So a little video review of the mission here to give you some idea of the goals of the mission and what they have in mind.
We got a couple of comments. One, the Chinese landed a rover. And did NASA send any probes to Mars between Viking and Sojourner? That's from Suresh.
Yep.
Also, the Kingsford Briquette asteroid?
Well, that goes back to that other one. That's a
okay.
That was me.
You're funny, Matt.
It always looked like a, you know, a charcoal briquette to me.
Is that Bennu that you're talking about?
Yeah, I think so.
Okay. Yeah, Bennu, I'm surprised I was just as rocky that they picked that one, but it's right trajectory, I guess. So anyway, Suresh's question. NASA, did NASA send any probes to Mars between Viking and Sojourn?
Ron's doing the video.
Mars is in development and has an ambitious mission. Decades of Mars research from previous spacecraft have shown the planet not only had water in the ancient past, but had environments that could have supported life.
Mars is our neighboring planet and in many ways the most similar to us, and certainly in its history. And the question whether ancient life was there is still the question that keeps us up at night.
Mars 2020 has two new objectives: to specifically seek the signs of life and then sample materials and prepare a cache that could be returned to Earth by a future mission.
Mars 2020 is really the essential first part of a sample return mission. So it actually looks at the environment of these samples and then collects them and stores them. Afterwards, we will, of course, go and bring these samples back. So Mars 2020 is the first half of a return trip.
The Mars 2020 mission, to the maximum extent possible, follows the Mars Science Laboratory Curiosity mission. We're going to use very similar rocket, very similar cruise stage, very similar entry, descent, and landing, and the rover, when you step back, will look almost identical.
Not only were a lot of designs already developed for the most part, but we're also using a lot of spare hardware that we had from MSL or Curiosity for Mars 2020. If you know where to look on lab, you can walk around and see a lot of the EDL hardware and the crew stage hardware that's already been built.
And this is really important for understanding why this mission makes sense. We have to do relatively little in the way of new development. And this saves money, it saves risk, saves time. It's the right way to pursue this kind of mission. Mars 2020 also features new technologies for entry, descent, and landing, allowing it to target a smaller landing zone and even divert from known risks in the area.
It means that we can both go to places that are maybe more interesting to the scientists because we're able to handle places with more hazards, as well as land closer to the things that they're interested in off the bat. So we get to the science that they care about and more quickly.
The three key sites that we are considering right now share one thing in common. They are all environments that might have been habitable in the very distant past. One of them is the floor of an ancient lake. Another is a hot spring. And the third one is a site where hot water interacted with rocks in the shallow subsurface. We have instruments on board which are expressly designed to seek evidence of ancient life, what we call biosignatures. And we have the capability to prepare samples, drill them out of a rock, seal them in a tube, so that a future mission could go and bring them up. We call that caching.
So it is a first of a new type of mission, which is to bring samples back to the best labs we have, which are here on Earth. Mars 2020 is a pivotal mission in our search for life that could finally answer the age-old question, are we alone?
There we go. So a quick review of some of the objectives: covering the geology of Mars, learning about early Mars, looking back in time to see if we see any evidence of astrobiology, any forms of life that may have been in the ancient history of Mars. Also the sample caching. This is pretty ambitious, to take samples of the surface and to bring them back to the Earth. Bringing them back, as he said, is going to be a separate mission. We'll talk about that in a little bit. And also to prepare for humans, to find out if there's any resource on Mars that we could use in situ that we wouldn't have to bring along from Earth to help out humans. So the landing site was selected back in 2018. You notice the video was very future tense. Yes, that was before the launch itself. You saw them building the probe in 2018. And yes, if you're familiar with the Mars rovers, this looks just like Curiosity. In fact, it uses a lot of the same components. It was launched in 2020 in July, cruised to Mars, landed in February of 2021, and is now undergoing surface operations. So the tools on board are pretty exciting. Some of them are very similar to Curiosity's, but some are different. And let's do just a quick little review to talk about the different instruments on board to provide some different insight into the ancient surface of Mars. First off, on the body, we have the RIMFAX back here in the corner, built by Norway. This thing is a radar, to ground penetrating radar, so we can actually see underneath the surface using this radar. Up here, this container on the corner, this is MOXIE. And this is one of those devices to see if we can use Mars resource. It converts CO2 to oxygen. Now, I know you've heard about that before. Plants do that. They clip off the carbon, keep that, and then release oxygen back into the atmosphere. Well, we're coming up with a machine that can do that. Now, the Martian atmosphere is 98% carbon dioxide. So if we can convert some of that to oxygen that we can use for breathing and for rocket fuel, that's awesome. And then finally, the RTG, the power plant back here. It's a radioisotope thermoelectric generator, a chunk of plutonium covered with thermocouples. And as the plutonium decays, those thermocouples provide that electricity. So a battery that'll last about 20 years. Up here on the mast, we've got its head, and in the head, we've got the SuperCam built by France. The SuperCam is both a telescope and a laser. So the laser fires into a rock, and as the smoke comes out of the rock face, the camera then looks at the smoke and analyzes the spectrum from it. So then it can tell what sort of rock was made or what sort of rock was in that hole that they're drilling into. So a way that you can sample rock from a distance. Just below that, you see the panoramic camera, the MassCam Z. That's these two eyes right here, just like you. Perseverance has two eyes, so it can see in stereo. And that's something you can go out to the website and check out a lot of the stereo footage that they've been posting. And then the Meta probe here on the halfway up the mast, they've added sensors to measure temperature, wind speed, and tracking the weather on Mars, barometric pressure, and it even has a microphone, so we can hear the wind blowing on Mars, as thin as it is. Out here on the arm, it's got a fully articulated arm, including a shoulder, elbow, and wrist, and then holding it in his hand, it's got five different tools, including Pixel, which is an X-ray spectrometer, Sherlock, which is a UV spectrometer, Watson, which is a microscopic camera, and finally, its drill. The RSS sample drill to reach down, dig a hole out of the ground and take the materials from that and then get that ready to send back to Earth. And finally, and this was kind of an add-on at the end of the construction, they decided to add this helicopter. This helicopter, which they eventually named Ingenuity, is just sort of a proof of concept thing. Very small little device, and we'll see some footage from it. But in the atmosphere of Mars, with such a thin atmosphere, you really got to spin up a helicopter blade to make it fly. And so the goal was just to get this thing to fly. They thought through a month of operation, get about five flights if they could. They're already up to 14 and planning more. So we'll get to more results from the helicopter in a little bit here. So there you see some of the data that we'll see from the MassCam Z. The RIMFAX looking down through the ground at structures underneath the surface, Meta watching the weather, the SuperCam getting spectroscopy data, Watson with its microscope, Pixel with its X-ray, and Sherlock with its UV, and then finally the boring device, the drill, to take the samples. So here's a timeline. On the right side is present day. On the left side is 5 billion years ago. About 4.5 billion years ago, both the Earth and Mars formed. And they would have looked very similar from the data that we've got from Curiosity, Spirit, Opportunity, Pathfinder, Viking. Mars was once wet. In fact, the entire northern hemisphere was covered with an ocean. And we see proof of that in the rock and in the rock samples and in the erosion on the surface. So we know that they were both very similar, but everything changed about 4 billion years ago. Mars lost its magnetic field. Without a magnetic field, you can't keep your atmosphere. And without an atmosphere, you can't keep your water. So everything changed on Mars during that time. So our magnetic field is caused by the iron inside the Earth spinning around with the mantle. And as it spins, it creates a dynamo effect, which creates a magnetic field that covers the planet. When the solar wind comes by, that magnetic field protects our atmosphere and keeps us nice and safe inside. Now, Mars had one of those until it didn't. Mars is twice as far from the sun and only half the size of Earth. And so the inside cooled off. And when the inside cooled off, it stopped spinning. Without spinning, no dynamo, no magnetosphere. And then there goes your atmosphere. The MAVEN probe is another JPL probe currently in orbit around Mars. It's measuring how fast the sun is tearing the Martian atmosphere off. And it showed evidence that that's exactly what's been going on. So now the Martian atmosphere is down to 1/100th that of the Earth's atmosphere. So the water dried up. About 80% of the water on the surface dried up. We think there's about 20% left over down inside the surface, frozen down in the permafrost below the surface of Mars. But most of the water's gone. So what happened to life during that time? Well, at that same time on Earth, life was just starting to emerge. Did some life emerge on Mars as well? So that's what Perseverance is hoping to find out. Looking for evidence of astrobiology, some sort of fossilized or maybe even current microscopic organisms, maybe single cell, maybe multi-cell. That was about the time that it started to form on Earth. And then, of course, after billions of years later, we finally start to see the diversity of life that we have today. But for a long time, it was just prokaryotes, single-celled organisms. Then we get to the eukaryotes, the multi-celled organisms, but maybe we can find some fossilized life. So we've pretty much convinced ourselves that nothing's going to walk up to the rover and tap on the window and say, hey, you can't park here. But if we find any life, it's likely this branch where we get to just single-celled organisms. Because without water, without atmosphere, and lots of radiation on the surface, not much of chance of life during this time. So maybe if there's nothing left, we'll at least find some fossilized evidence. So this data is, I'm sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, we got a couple queued up here. We've got one comment from Wyatt. A lot of people are talking about terraforming Mars. Why Mars of all planets? Why not Venus? It's got leagues better atmosphere. We just got to get creative. That's an interesting.
Yeah. So one thing about terraforming is a lot of people think, well, gee, if we could just clean up Mars, then we can live there once we ruin the Earth. Well, if we can clean up Mars, we can fix the Earth. I mean, it's a similar technology. If you need to build an atmosphere out of nothing, you're going to be able to take an atmosphere like Earth's and fix it up. So the technology paths would be very similar. They talk about Mars just because Venus is so ridiculously hot. Now, we could live in the clouds of Venus where we don't get into that heat. It's a rather comfortable temperature. But to go underneath those clouds, incredible temperatures, 900 degrees Fahrenheit, and crushing pressures. Okay, the surface pressure of Venus is like 93 bar, which is 93 times that of the Earth's. If you ever dive into a pool and you go down, you feel your ears start to pop. Okay, you go down 300 feet and that's 10 bars of pressure. So you can imagine how much that's going to hurt on your ears. 30 bars of pressure is enough to kill you. It's 90 on Venus. You're going to get squished like a grape. That probe I showed you, the picture of the probe on the surface, none of them, of the eight they sent, only four of them made it, and none of them last for more than 2 hours. Just such a ridiculously caustic environment. Nothing could survive. So Mars is much more benign in comparison. All we've got to do is pump some oxygen back in the atmosphere and replace the magnetosphere. Yeah.
Suresh is also asking, if Mars is now geologically dead and has no core dynamo, what is causing the Mars quakes that are being detected?
You know, we've had to revise the idea of it being completely dead. It's mostly dead, not dead dead, but mostly dead. But it's also the cooling. The cooling as it shrinks then creates quakes, just like we see on the moon. The moon is still cooling on the inside, and as it does, things crack and quake. And so we do pick up some seismic signals from that cracking.
Kind of like the Minnesota lakes in the winter.
Yes. Sitting up in Lake Superior, watching Halley's Comet go by. Listen to it crack. So these pictures are from the Global Surveyor. Now, this blue is indicative of a very low altitude. In fact, the lowest stuff here is purple, and then blue, green, yellow, orange, red, and then brown, and the very tallest are white. Now, this is not water, but it sure could have been, because that's where the water was. This is the ancient shore of that ocean. You can even see where the water flowed down through the highlands, carved out Valles Marineris, dumping into Utopia Planitia, all sorts of stuff. So where should we land? The idea of sending this probe to look for ancient life. Well, first off, it's got to be a habitable environment. If we look way back when it was wet, hopefully it would be habitable. We want to see rocks that were formed under conditions conducive to biosignature preservation, not something that would have wiped out any evidence, you know, like lava flow, things like around volcanoes. And a diversity of rock types would help. Finding the building blocks for life would help complete that puzzle. And so those were the things we were looking for, the criteria we needed to select a site where we would land. So there were three: Jezero, Northeast Syrtis Major, and the Columbia Hills. Each of them had their different advantages, with an ancient crust, a volcanic past, or an ancient delta in an ancient lake with a diverse mineralogy, or the Columbia Hills, which is actually where Spirit Rover was, where there's an ancient hot spring, evidence of water at one time. So there they are, Columbia Hills, Syrtis Major, and the Jezero Crater. In the fall of 2018, they picked Jezero. In fact, here was the region of Jezero they hoped to land. Jezero was a lake. You can see it right here. The water flowed in from this valley right here. In fact, the crater got so full that water dumped out the other side. There's the outflow channel. So really, everything from this area here would have flowed down into Jezero before it dumped out into Utopia Planitia and the Isidis Impact Basin. Here you can see the mouth of the river inlet formed a delta. Right here, you can see that delta. So deltas form when water's running in a river, running downhill, dumps out into the lake. It loses its velocity, and without the velocity, it can't carry that material anymore. So the material settles down and settles into this delta. Well, that's like a geological sweet shop. Let's just find stuff that's there, and we will have a variety of different species that we can check out. Here you can see iron, magnesium, one of the building blocks of life, and olivine distributed all across that delta. So we're looking at the watershed of that area. Any water that ended up in this area would have drained down through these creeks and rivulets and dumped into this crater until it was full, depositing its stuff that it was carrying, the sedimentation it was carrying, and then pouring out through the outlet valley there. What a great location to pick. So here we can see where the ancient lake shore would have been getting near to the end of when the lake was formed. You see the edge of the delta here, and there, the OEB, this is the landing site where Perseverance ended up. So originally you start with an oval, you hope to hit somewhere in there, and that's where they ended up. I think you saw in the video that they mentioned that we had additional technology this time. We were able to fly with the sky crane more precisely and find places that would have been a little bit more dangerous to land back when we landed Curiosity. But now we had control of the sky crane, with some AI that could see the surface in much greater detail, and it could pick a spot and land in it, and it was going to be much more safe. So they were able to get a little risky and get much closer to that delta that helped cut the time. So we've got different layers to look at, including the mafic crater floor. This helps us understand the Martian carbon cycle. This mafic floor would have formed when the meteor hit that formed Jezero crater. So if we want to date the crater, we start with this and everything else is younger. All this stuff came after the original crater, this pile, this delta. So that helps us establish a timeline. Now we know this because we can look at Death Valley. And these features that we see on Earth are analogs to what we see on Mars. So it helps us, it helps inform what we see on Mars and then helps us understand where we need to look because we can see these examples on Earth and there they are on Mars. Now, remember, this is a current view too. This view is from an area that is probably likely 3 billion years old and hasn't been touched since. So we're looking back in time. And again, understanding Mars right now helps us understand the ancient Earth. Now, as that stuff started to dry up, it started to deposit things, what they call the bathtub ring of olivine and carbonate-bearing materials. This is the kind of stuff where we would see volcanic ash, easily dated. We see that along the floor of the Jezero crater as well. So here it is in the Colorado National Monument. What we've learned from here, now we know what to look for here on Mars. And then finally, we get to the delta. And the delta is such a rich deposit of organic, potentially organic material. And that's where there's the real interest. Now, oil companies look for ancient deltas on Earth. Well, what are oil companies looking for? Oil. And why do they look for ancient deltas? Because what's oil made out of? Ancient life. Fossilized dinosaurs, fossilized life, organic material from long ago that has fossilized into hydrocarbons, fossil fuel. And so if you're looking for ancient organic material, you can find it in a delta. Well, that's what we're looking for on Mars. And so it's off to the delta we go. Here's a delta in Alaska. You can see all the colors from all the organic processes going on in the runoff. And there's the delta on Mars. So what we learn on Earth from these analogs, we can apply that to Mars. And what we learn on Mars, we can then go back to ancient Earth and understand how all this formed. We get up along the shoreline now, and we're looking at the carbonate deposits. These are the stromatolites, microbial fossils, ancient shellfish, maybe, in these deposits, because that's what we find here on Earth. Here we see some stromatolites formed along the coast of Walker Lake here in Nevada, and you can see as the lake dried up, it leaves these bathtub rings behind. And there we have the same type of marginal deposits on Mars. Finally, we get up to the crater wall. These are the oldest of the rocks because not only do we see the crater floor that was formed by the impact, but the rocks that were there are tossed up onto the crater wall and exposed. So these are some of the oldest rocks we're going to find in this area, just like we found at Papagai Crater in Russia. Same process, but here we are on Mars and looking back in time, not present day, but 3.5 billion years ago. And that's going to help inform what we know today. So here's the path that Perseverance hopes to take. It landed here. It's going to climb up onto the delta, up along the shoreline, and then up over the crater wall. That process should take about 2 years. After that, it's gravy, whatever we can get out of it. Let me go ahead and call up a video that's going to show the fly path that we're planning on taking, a flyover, sorry, of the area that the rover is going to drive on. There we go.
This flyover was produced from NASA images taken from orbit. The blue circle indicates the area the rover will likely land. The arcing hills in the center, about 1,600 feet high and are the rim of Jezero Crater. The goal of Mars 2020 is to learn whether life ever existed on Mars. It's too cold and dry for life to exist on the Martian surface today. But after Jezero Crater formed billions of years ago, water filled it to form a deep lake, about the same size as Lake Tahoe. Eventually, as Mars climate changed, Lake Jezero dried up and surface water disappeared from the planet. An ancient lake is a fantastic place to pursue our goal of looking for possible Martian life. On Earth, lakes are filled with living creatures. Evidence of that life is often preserved in the mud and sand deposited on the bottom of the lake. So, we use the rover's instruments to explore the rocks of the ancient lake bed. Here we can see evidence of the former lake. The canyon cutting through the crater rim was carved by a river. As the water entered the lake, it slowed and dropped the sand and mud it was carrying to form the fan-shaped delta. The white line is a path the rover might follow in its first 2 years, called the Prime Mission. During this period, we use the rover science instruments to analyze the lake sediments. After we explore the delta, we hope to investigate the shoreline of the former lake. To get there, we have to traverse around a sea of modern sand dunes. From this perspective, you can see former shorelines curving around a headland. We can picture waves in Lake Jezero beating on a sandy beach. And finally, we will press on to the crater rim. Jezero Crater formed when a large object collided with Mars, excavating rocks from deep in the Martian crust, exposing them in the rim for us to study. These rocks would have been hot shortly after the impact and may have hosted hot springs. Deposits from these springs would be another target in our search for possible ancient life on Mars.
There we go. And again, that was future tense, but that footage was from the Global Surveyor. So we do have footage reference. That's actual footage from the surface. So let's see what that looks like. As it goes, it's going to take samples. We mentioned the drill. The drill is going to drill down with a container, seal that container up. It's going to take 43 samples total. We're going to have some witness tubes down here, which will simply be taken in the area, closed up to contain the atmosphere from the area so that when they check the tube itself, they can understand that that wasn't, you know, whatever is in that tube didn't come from Earth, wasn't in the tube already, that sort of thing. So these witness tubes are controls. And then they have six spares in case they run into a spot where it's, hey, this is interesting. So the drill is going to drill down through the rock in rotary mode, almost like a jackhammer. And then once completed, it's going to pick that up, close it up, slide it into this tube and seal it up. And then it's going to, they originally talked about putting it inside a container like this and then leave the container on Mars. They've changed that. They decided that they're just going to leave the tubes on the surface. So they're going to take samples from each of the different areas we talked about, the delta, the floor, the marginal lake deposits, the crater rim. So the plan is to take some samples from each. And then once it leaves them on the ground, after 2 years, the rover's primary mission will be over. All the tubes should be filled. And that's when they're going to send the probe to go pick up the samples. Now, this is currently under design. The probe's going to fly into orbit around Mars, send a lander, which will have a rover to pick up the samples, bring them back to the lander, put them on a rocket, and then send that rocket back up into space, rendezvousing with the orbiter, and then flying back to Earth. Ambitious. We've never done this. We've never brought samples. Well, anytime we brought samples back from anywhere, we had astronauts carrying them. So Mars, much more challenging. And remember, all this process is automated. You know, when we see the rover working, that signal is anywhere from 5 to 15 minutes old. And so you can't just drive the thing like an RC car. You have to teach it how to drive by itself and then set it loose. There are some drivers at JPL like Carrie Bean. When she drives the rover, she's not looking through the camera and turning the steering wheel. She's sending it a command to, hey, go over to this point, stop, and call me when you get there. But the rover's smart enough. It knows how to drive around obstacles. It finds a sand dune, it'll back up and go around it. And so that's what's really exciting, is that we've got our robot there. We don't have the boots there yet, but at least our bots can be a good substitute for us. So hopefully we get some good data. So on February 18th, just like Curiosity and its 7 minutes of terror, the cruise stage separated. The probe in its atmospheric shell entered the atmosphere, using the atmosphere to brake and slow down from the 27,000 miles an hour speed down to about 700. Once into the atmosphere, it popped a parachute out. That slowed it down some. The heat shield from underneath separated, and now the rover can see the ground with its radar. Now, because the atmosphere of Mars is too thin, the parachute can't get you all the way down. So at about 350 seconds, the rover separates in the sky crane, and we're in powered flight. The sky crane brings it down, sets it down on the ground, and then breaks the bridle, and the sky crane flies away. And no one can touch this thing when it's coming down, because by the time they get the message that it's entered the atmosphere, it's already crashed or landed. And that's why they talk about the 7 minutes of terror. Cool. This probe had to be programmed to do all of this all by itself. So it's an incredible accomplishment. And it is as amazing as it sounds.
Yeah.
So let's go ahead and look at, I'm sorry, go ahead, Matt.
Yeah, we had a couple queued up here. I think it was Mark or Vault maybe. Is there any collaboration of NASA with the Chinese and the rover?
No. No, in fact, the Chinese have been very quiet about the results.
Okay, and Trina was asking, how many times did Mars get hit to knock it out of the Goldilocks zone? Is that part of the equation here, or was it formed with that stuff way out where it's at?
You know, there's no evidence that it's moved.
Yeah.
But that's certainly something that, the fossil record might give us some indication about.
My own question was, Well,
if I could, Matt.
Yeah.
Mars actually is in the Goldilocks zone.
Oh.
With a thicker atmosphere, it had water on the surface.
Right.
So the outer edge of the Goldilocks zone means it's too cold. Well, the only reason Mars is cold now is because it's missing all of its atmosphere.
Okay.
So with that thicker atmosphere, before the sun took it out, it was plenty warm on the surface to have liquid water.
Yeah, I feel a little like Ed McMahon here, but let's see. My own question was, these missions to Mars had a history of sometimes they land, sometimes they wouldn't for various reasons. And what's their batting average doing these days? It sounds like it's getting better and better.
It's about 60%. And when you include everybody, by the way, the Russians have had some hit. The India had one that didn't make it. England had two that didn't make it. So it's been a problem. In fact, one of ours hit the ground on approach. It didn't fire its rockets to tell it it landed, and it crashed into the surface. Another one just disappeared, having not entered the atmosphere at the right spot. That was the one where we thought they were sending us metric units. Turns out they were sending us English units.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then of course the Mars Observer back in the 80s that as it primed its engine to begin its braking maneuver, it suddenly stopped broadcasting. So we think a line busted and it spun out of control. So, yep, it's not a sure thing getting to Mars.
Well, it's a hard atmosphere. It's not enough to use the aero braking, and it's too much to just fly in, right?
Exactly. So, exactly right.
Yeah, so it's a really tricky spot to be in. Is our average getting better over these 40 years or 30 years that we've been doing this?
I'll tell you, the last one made it. Nice. So like the Minnesota Twins, there's hope for next year.
Okay. 2015.
All right, let's take a look at the EDL footage.
Maneuver where the spacecraft will jettison the entry balance masses.
Now, this is taken video from the entire process and then gone back and stuck it into the timeline. So this wasn't live. This was all what we got back from the rover.
Navigation has confirmed that the parachute has deployed, and we are seeing significant deceleration in the velocity. Our current velocity is 440 meters per second at an altitude of about 12 kilometers from the surface of Mars.
There goes the heat shield.
Heat shield set.
Perseverance has now slowed to subsonic speeds, and the heat shield has been separated. This allows both the radar and the cameras to get their first look at the surface. Current velocity is 145 meters per second and an altitude of about 9.5 kilometers above the surface.
I was hoping to see a dust plume off that.
Nav filter converge. Velocity solution 3.3 meters per second. Altitude 7.4 kilometers.
Now has radar lock on the ground. Current velocity is about 100 meters per second, 6.6 kilometers above the surface.
So you can see the edge of the delta on the right side there.
Perseverance is continuing to descend on the parachute. We are coming up on the initialization of terrain relative navigation and subsequently the priming of the landing engines. Our current velocity is about 90 meters per second at an altitude of 4.2 kilometers.
And by the way, we saw a lot of animation tonight. This is an animation. This is actual footage, and it just blows me away.
We have confirmation that the Lander Vision System has produced a valid solution and part of terrain relative navigation.
Priming.
TVA is nominal.
We have priming of the landing engines.
You can follow the icons on the bottom here. There it goes.
Current velocity is 83 meters per second at about 2.6 kilometers from the surface of Mars.
It's broken away from the back shell, and now they've started powered flight.
We are currently performing the divert maneuver. Current velocity is about 75 meters per second at an altitude of about a kilometer off the surface of Mars.
TRN Safety Bravo.
We have completed our terrain relative navigation. Current speed is about 30 meters per second, altitude of about 300 meters off the surface of Mars. We have started our constant velocity.
Picking up some dust.
Means we are conducting the sky crane, about to conduct the sky crane maneuver.
There goes the sky crane. You can see that on the upper left, and there's the rover being lowered on the lower left.
About 20 meters off the surface.
This is better than SpaceX gets.
I know, isn't it?
We're getting signals from MRO. Tango Delta.
Touchdown confirmed. Perseverance safely on the surface of Mars, ready to begin seeking the sands of past life.
There you go. Good stuff. Just amazing.
I love how they do it like it's live, but it already happened. So
right, exactly. Yep. Yeah, it gives us some nice nice vantage point. So the exploration has begun. There's Ingenuity. It's had, like I said, they were hoping for five flights. They're up to 14 now. And there you can see the drill. Now, the first drill extraction didn't work as hoped. And sure, they drilled a hole, but notice all that dust around the top there. The integrity of the material inside let go. So the tube came up empty. That's a look down inside that hermetically sealed tube. But they have since drilled again and they've filled, I think they're up to six tubes by now. Here you can see the current location. Here's the landing site here. They've driven along this dune up through these fields. There you can see where the rover's located and that's where Ingenuity is located.
Apparently, Google Maps is working on Mars now.
Oh, perfectly. All right. I want to hop to Ingenuity because we've got some great footage of that. Of course, there's stuff on the rover. The arm swings around. It does selfies and that sort of thing. But I love this helicopter stuff. And I need to wrap up here. I don't want to go too long. So let me bring up the footage on Ingenuity here. So all of this footage is from Perseverance itself showing you the helicopter on the ground. There you can see the carbon blade spinning up. It is solar powered. That's a solar panel at the top there. That's where it gets its power from. And then the carbon blades. Here you can see some footage from the landing. There is Perseverance. There is Ingenuity underneath. So it took its arm, stuck it underneath so the camera could show you Ingenuity being deployed. So the legs come down and there we go. Do we have a mic open? Okay, now we're back. So there it is sitting on the surface. This is cool. This is a selfie. So the camera at the end of the arm is taking panoramic shots, and then they stitch that all together. So you can't tell that the arm is actually taking this picture because it stitches itself out of the view when you put frames together. But there you can see Perseverance is like, hey, here's my helicopter over here. And here's the first flight. Went up 5 meters, hovered, and then came back down. Wildly successful. And again, remember, no one's flying this thing. They had to teach it how to fly all by itself. And you can imagine with this lack of atmosphere, how fast those blades have got to go. We're talking about like 1200 to 1300 RPM to get them to spin up fast enough to bite into the air of that very, very thin atmosphere. Now, this was enough, but now they've got all these flights under their belt. They've gotten much more. They've gotten many more flights than they had hoped. They had hoped for 5 over a month, and now they're still going, and now they're up to 13 and hoping for more. Now, during this time, it's been getting warmer on Mars. Okay, so here's the North Pole. The polar cap is shrinking, and it's actually getting larger at the South Pole. So what happens is as that carbon dioxide evaporates and then condenses in the South Pole, you start to lose atmospheric pressure. So you've got to spin the prop up even more. So it was doing a spin test, and it ended up finding some trouble. It picked up a wobble, and it wasn't quite sure what that wobble was about. So before it even takes off, it starts to spin the motors to make sure everything's working properly and to make sure that the flight controls are going to work, both the pitch and the squash plate. So as it spun up, it realized it was shaking and went, oh, hold on, we're not going to fly. So here you see the little wiggle test with the servos, and we're going to get a close-up look at what that looks like. So there's the mechanism underneath, and it's just like a regular helicopter on the Earth, except instead of big hydraulic rams, we've got these little servos. So there's the rotor blade, the pitch link, which changes the pitch of the blades, and then the swash plate. And if you know how helicopters work, the swash plate pushes the leading edge down and the trailing edge up, and that's what produces more lift on the back. And that's why a helicopter sort of tips nose down as it goes forward. He had to balance that just right, so you're getting part lift and part forward momentum. And that's how a helicopter moves, how it translates. So if you're just going to hover, just go straight up and come back down. You only need the pitch, but you need that additional servo to run the swash plate. Now, right now, they're taking a break because Mars is now behind the sun. So with the sun in the way of Mars, communication gets very sketchy. So they just take a break, and they have given the rover and the helicopter instructions on what to do during this break. And then we'll just get back to it when Mars has moved away from superior conjunction enough that we can now reliably talk to it. So here's some footage from the camera on board Ingenuity. Now, remember, this is just a proof of concept model. All they wanted to do is get this thing to fly on the surface. And they've got to do so much more than that. So they didn't have sensors. They didn't have any other data or telemetry gathering devices. They just have this camera. There you can see the rover. The helicopter foot there on the left. There you can see the carbon fiber foot of the helicopter. And you can see it's getting some dust on it. You can imagine in such a dry, arid surface, you're going to have a lot of static electricity. And so that static is making that dust cling to the landing. Here you can see it landed in a sand dune and actually depressed the feet down into the surface, made some little craters. And you can see that even the helicopter blade spinning is not enough to knock that dust off, which also helps us understand why Spirit and Opportunity had problems with their solar panels. There's a shot from Spirit's pan cam, and you can see all the dust that built up. Now, some people would say, well, why didn't you just have a fan on it to blow the dust away? Well, as you can see with the helicopter, a fan wouldn't have done it. A fan wouldn't have done it. Now, granted, this thing was only built to last for 3 months, and it lasts for 7 years and 14 years. So they did just fine. But certainly getting the dust off the solar panels might be some design concern in future rovers.
Yeah, we have a couple questions queued up here. What method did China use for land rovers? Anything?
They use rockets to put their rover on the ground.
So they're not moving. What about the land? Maybe I'm misunderstanding the question. Did they have a similar land rover? Oh, to land, I guess it's a weird question. To land a rover? So they use rockets.
Right. They use rockets to set down on the ground.
Okay. All right. I guess that's the only question open right now.
Okay. All right. Well, I'm going to go ahead and wrap it up there. Exploration continues with our Perseverance rover, Curiosity, still digging away over in Gusev Crater, and the Ingenuity helicopter ready for even more flights and proving that getting around on Mars, we now have another option.
Okay, Mark.
Thank you, Ron.
My pleasure. Thanks for your attention, everybody.
Is there any further questions from the rest of the group? Oh, I see one. What are the next missions coming up on Mars? Not just from NASA.
The next one for Mars is this Euro 2020 rover. I don't have a launch date on that, but COVID kind of pulled that to a halt. That's a European Space Agency probe, ESA, and they're still working on getting that. The rover's all done. They just have to package it up for flight and get it on board the launch vehicle and get that going. And of course, they're working on the rover, the probe that's going to retrieve the samples from the surface. And that's ambitious because we've never done that. We've never sent something back off the surface. You know, when it lands, it stays. It's kind of cute. All the kids are like, well, how are we going to get the rover back? It's like, eh, we're not. They're there for keeps. It's a one-way trip.
What's the design on the landing of the European rover?
I'm sorry?
What's the design of the lander for the European rover?
Oh, similar I had to, that. It's very similar, except they've got a long drill on a frame that's going to reach down into it's actually going to travel along this track that's at the front of the rover. So their drilling equipment is slightly different. But if you're interested, it's ExoMars, the ExoMars rover.
Cool. Good. All right, everyone. Thank you, Ron. And looks like success. So thank you for your time.
Oh, you're very welcome. Glad to help out.
Oh, wait, one last question. Do you know why they did not keep the samples in one container, why they're scattering them around? A lot of extra work.
I do not know. And yes, it's going to be a lot of extra work hunting those down. And you did see sand dunes. Okay. So are you going to just drive up and dig under the sand and figure out where this thing is? Yeah. One surprised me.
They got GPS on them then? GPS?
No. No, they're just tubes.
Martian geocaching.
Yes, exactly. Exactly. Without
geo.
Yeah.
Well, very good. Thank you very much, Mr. Ambassador, and I appreciate your being on here tonight, and fascinating as always. Thank you to everybody. We had 73 people for most of that presentation, and it's really a good crowd, and look forward to seeing y'all next month as well.
Yep. See you next month, everyone. Good night.